There's a recent study by Blaxall et al. And a team of other researchers said that the cost of treating autism in this country by 2035, so within 10 years, will be $1 trillion a year.
That study was retracted, so I don't think we can rely on that study to have any weight.
Autism destroys families. More importantly, it destroys our greatest resource, which are our children. And these are kids who will never pay taxes. They'll never hold a job. They'll never play baseball. They'll never write a poem. They'll never go out on a date. Many of them will never use a toilet unassisted. And we have to recognize we are doing this to our children.
So the reality is that autism is being oversimplified right now. So autism is actually a very diverse condition. So there are individuals for which they are minimally verbal. They have severe cognitive disabilities. They may never live independently. They may never have a job that pays taxes. That doesn't impact their meaning in life. They are still important and they're still valued. There's also individuals with autism that can live independently, that may go to college, that have competitive jobs, that can pay their own bills. That doesn't mean that their problems are less important. It means that they're different, and we shouldn't be categorizing this broad spectrum of autism with such a narrow comment.
So first of all, again, he didn't say any of that. So this is that typical type of thing where when they want to try to, you know, go after somebody, he never said anything about the value of the individual and who was worth more than anything. So she's just trying to attack him on that. Now, I do know that a lot of families were offended by hearing that, and I do appreciate that. And I do disagree with him in some way in that he is, yeah, of course, there's a wide variety. And that on one end of the spectrum, we have people that are nonverbal or very low verbal. That's where I focus my attention, by the way, and a lot of my research. So I work with those families around the world every day. And we also can change that. We get many of those kids to be able to speak. I had a young man, for instance, he was 23 years old, and his whole, you know, when he came here, he was verbal, not great, but he was verbal. But his goal was to be able to get a driver's license and pass his driver's test and then get a job and then get an apartment and then get a girlfriend in that order. That's what he wanted, right? And so he came in and, you know, he was reading at a fifth grade level and comprehending at a first grade level, okay? Mm-hmm. So we worked with him and this kid was amazing. He came in twice a week here. He worked did an hour every day at home of things that we gave him. He was amazing. In less than 1 year, he passed his driver's test and was driving. He now is reading at a college level and comprehending at a 10th grade level. And his mom just told me that he now, you know, reads the paper and talks to her about current events. And he has a job. We're working on the apartment next and then the girlfriend, right? So now, that's the thing. Robert Kennedy's talking about this in somewhat static terms, meaning that there are certain kids and they're never going to change and they're never going to get better. And, you know, I never take that hope away. The fact mm-hmm. of the matter is that with the vast majority of treatment options that are out there, he's right in that most of those kids may never actually recover or may, you know, not function and therefore may not go on to get jobs and may not pay taxes and everything like that. But mm-hmm. the difference I take is that I believe that can be changed with the right treatment. I don't think that has to be. That's not destiny. It's something that can be altered. And that's what I'm fighting for every day is to be able to give people and those parents. And, you know, he's right. I mean, 80 to 85% of marriages end up in divorce with families of kids with autism. And it's, you know, and on the non-speaking end of it, it can be very difficult. You know, there are many families that it brings them closer together. And, it's unbelievable how the siblings can get involved in all of that. Mm-hmm. And, you know, most families, I think if you ask them, in many of them, they would look at the autistic child as a gift and would not change things per se. They would like their child to speak or be able to, you know, be more functional. But so I think, you know, I think his language may have come off as harsh. I don't think he meant it that way. I think he's looking at it again in the idea that, you know, and I think it, a lot of his information is coming from people in the biomedical world who really understand the immune system and how that works and works with autism, but really don't understand the brain. So that's where, at some point, I wish he would speak to me and or read my book. And I have met him years ago, and he, I you know, so I do think that he's familiar with it. But I mean, I would give him advice more about what's actually happening in the brain and understanding it. And I think he would be very open to listening to, you know, different opinions from different people. But right now, I think he's getting a more narrow view of what's happening and what's possible. And but other than that, I don't think he is saying that in any way to discredit people or make people. So I think what she just said was completely off base.
Yeah, and I think we've been through most of, we'll play it just to make sure we don't miss any of what she said, because I didn't want to chop this video up myself, because I didn't want right. to, people say, oh, you're nitpicking. I wanted to play it to the full extent. Right. But before that, I think RFK Jr. comes from a background of environmental lawyer.
Yes.
And so that's also something that's probably affecting a lot of the way he's speaking about this. The other thing too is I think they had already clip specific segment, because I saw the full video of him talking is actually like 36 minutes. Mm-hmm. So I think they clip specific segments, sure. And I'll do myself a favor and go and listen to the full thing. I just didn't get a chance to do that yet. Yeah. But I think those two things are also probably playing a, like she speaks more than he does in here, just when I was breaking it down. And so I think, yeah, it could definitely be given a fair shot so we can hear more of what he's saying, because maybe he's clarifying on some of these things. Mm-hmm. 2 seconds later, right? And so, but yeah, I'll finish what she has to say, then I'll jump into some of the specific questions. Actually, I was going to ask you before I go back here, do you, when she keeps saying oversimplification, and that, do you think she would say that about trying to find a unified theory or notion to explain all of this? Because what does she mean by oversimplification?
Listen, I mean, the all of these things are multifactorial. There are many different environmental and genetic factors. There's a lot happening in the brain. There's a wide variety of the way it presents. So I think that's what she means. But I think also, you know, to me, she probably doesn't have a clear-cut idea of what actually is happening in the brain in autism overall. I believe there is a universal theory that can explain all of it. I believe I published a paper and explained that. And I understand that there are all these complexities that come into play, but the bottom line is there is something happening to the brain that I think we can understand and that I think is pretty straightforward and that we can change. And all the other environmental factors. So I just, you know, I think that's kind of a line that a lot of people use, and especially in the research world, because there's so many different things you can look at and you need to be open. Mm-hmm. And remember that, you know, first of all, in research, it's really taboo to say causation, right? That, you know, correlation does not prove causation. Causation is a very hard thing to prove in general. But you can, and that's why even in my book, I don't say that we can prevent it. I don't say that this causes it. I say that these elevate the risk of having something. So that, you know, these environmental factors to different degrees in different people may elevate the risk of you having a child with autism or some other disability. But to draw a clear cut, you know, this causes this. It's almost impossible to do that in this case.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you for that. We'll let this here finish. We got about less than a minute.
That's right. There are some people for which They will never pay taxes, or the diagnosis is devastating. In others, or in which you want features to be prevented, some features of autism, like you want people to be able to speak, right? You don't want people to not be able to communicate. But for other people, some of the features of autism, they don't want prevented. I think it's kind of irresponsible to put everybody with autism into one broad umbrella when it comes to what individual families need and don't need, because that's highly variable.
Yeah, just for that, I mean, a lot of that relates to the whole neurodivergent movement. And there are many, many people in the autism world, typically on the higher functioning end of it, that say, listen, I don't need treatment. I'm fine. I don't need any help. Leave me alone. And that's fine. Meaning I totally agree with that. I don't think anybody should be, you know, forced to go through treatment. And they should always be treated with respect, and they should always be accepted no matter what the level of their disability. But by the same token, you know, there are families and individuals, if they say, hey, you know, please help me speak or help me stop these tics or these stimming or this OCD, that needs to be respected too. So even within the autism community, there's a lot of fighting over that. But so I think she's just kind of expressing that to a certain extent. And that's true. But I think she's completely misinterpreting what he's saying. He's not saying that, any of that. He's not implying any of that. But yet she's making that statement, you know, like, you know, which I think is a fair statement, but I don't think it's not what he was saying or trying to imply in any way.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was that was also my impression of it, where I felt like that video was more of a slam piece than because I didn't learn nothing from it initially. Okay. I was trying to figure out like, well, OK, so what? Are you saying that? And I felt like at times we're splitting hair, if I can say that, but it didn't really help me understand. And that's where I thought, I was like, okay, well, this is more of a reflective of the infighting within the community, if he's a part of the community, than something to try and educate. And again, that's why I keep saying it. We're so happy and grateful to have you on to be able to really break this down for us and explain it to us. And, you know, as I'm clipping these things and putting it out there, I hope that some people who may disagree or who may have a different viewpoint can come and do what you just did here, which is sit down with us for an hour plus. And I do understand that it's a complex thing. Like, it's like the oversimplification element, where it's taken us over an hour to be able to just start to get a grasp of what is going on, right? Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, that was my impression of the video, and I'm really grateful that we got through to go through that.
Yeah, me too. I think it was great the way you did this, because I see these things, and I have been asked to comment on some of this. I was in Newsweek a couple of times, but as you said, like slanting, there was one big magazine that asked me to comment, and I think I didn't quite comment the way they wanted the piece to go, so I don't think they ended up putting it in there. But so I don't let politics sway what I'm going to say. You know what I mean? I really look at science. And I think, you know, that comes into play sometimes, unfortunately, and the bias that people have. And I think that, you know, overall, the majority of what he's saying is right and good and great, that we're getting a better. We are so unhealthy as a society, and it has only gotten worse. And the way that our government has regulated, you know, food and drugs and is definitely needs to be overhauled. And that's what he's saying, mm-hmm. primarily. And I will tell you, I've seen him lecture. He's a very, very bright guy, and he does know the environmental law. And basically, when it comes to vaccines, what he's saying is that, you know, we need to study them better. You know, we need to understand it better. Something's happening. That's what he's saying. Something's happening, and it's not just a genetic mutation. And we need to understand what that something is. And vaccines only get 5 months of studies when every other drug has 5 years. And if you get injured by a drug, you can sue the pharmaceutical company, but you can't with vaccines. So it lends itself to the potential for a lot of corruption. And that's what he's primarily saying. And he's saying that there's a lot of corruption looking at, you know, whether we let certain chemicals in our foods or, you know, whether we let drug companies advertise on TV. And, you know, and we need to look at that, because we're the wealthiest country on earth, but yet we're the most one of the most unhealthy countries. There's something wrong there, and we need to look at that. And that's, I think, his predominant message that we should all agree with and say, yeah, I agree with it, especially if it's affecting our children.